So thank you, Mike. And again, good afternoon and very happy new year to everyone. And glad, you know, there are so many folks joining our first monthly Institute and Women and Health meeting for 2021. And really hoping that at some stage we will be starting to doing in-person meeting, but until then, I think we'll Zoom meeting is working out very well so that we can, I think MIT and maybe many other institutions. So thank you, Laszlo, for inviting such an elite group. Again,
thank you.
Yeah, it's my pleasure to welcome Laszlo Boros, who is professor of pediatrics at UCLA. And he has been a member of the pediatrics department, I think, for more than 20 years now, or almost 20 years. And also a member of REI to start with, then LA Biomed and Lundquist. We really have a long association with him. His expertise in metabolomics, particularly in using stable isotopes to understand dynamics, equilibrium of various subcellular fractions, particularly in mitochondrial ATP and water biosynthesis, using proton tunneling, delocalization, and destabilization. He's a world expert in Deutenomics, which I think is his field, and I'm so glad that this is the first time when he introduced me to this topic, I think about 10 years back. Really excited to be part of some of the work what he's doing. Today we are going to hear about Deutenomics as well as particularly in its application to clinical medicine. And that's what I think the whole focus will be for next 40 to 45 minutes. So without further ado, Laszlo, take it from here. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rehan. And I would like to greet everybody who is joining this conference. I'm gonna share my screen if it works out okay. So as an overview, I would like to first talk about deuterium and especially how it relates to hydrogen, which is the first element of the periodic table. I'm gonna talk about the biochemistry of proton or hydrogen transfer and how those processes relate to deuterium. And I'm also going to talk about biosynthesis of ATP and metabolic water from low deuterium diets, which are mostly ketogenic diets, natural ketogenic diets, grass-fed animals, for that matter. And we're gonna talk about the clinical aspect of deuterium applications, high deuterium is fractionated and discriminated and lost during metabolic tracer studies. And I'm also gonna talk about breastfeeding and deuterium and meal production based on currently reviewed scientific literature, because we are planning with Dr. Michael Ross and with Dr. Rehan and Dr. Desai, we are planning to further study these scenarios in metabolic diseases. And I'm gonna talk about deuteronomics and radiology with our based on work from our colleagues from Yale University, and I'm going to cover some resources and some clinical cases. Now, I think the most important is to understand what the difference between a hydrogen and a deuterium, deuterium being the stable isotope of hydrogen. It's actually an unseen change in mass and size that is between deuterium and hydrogen. That means deuterium is actually twice as heavy and twice as big or large as hydrogen. And if you think about how important hydrogen is in our biological systems when it comes to making hydrogen bonds, transferring energy from one molecule to another, how important it is to reduce certain chemical bonds by hydrogen, and how important it is to stabilize protein structures and DNA structures by hydrogen bindings and hydrogen bonds, when there is a twice as heavy and twice as large isotope of hydrogen, it can create quite a significant problems in biology and in medicine for that matter. And this is what we are learning. This is what we are discovering these days. And our colleagues at the MIT in Holland and South Africa and in many other countries are actually collaborators and very eager to learn together more and more about the biochemistry of deuterium and how we can actually improve diagnostics medicine with this type of information that we are presenting today. Now, as we all know, that the most common appearance of hydrogen is in water, and the most abundant as well is in water. Our body is made up, significant portion of our body is made up by hydrogen by weight, not by size. About 65% of our body weight is coming from hydrogen. And obviously there's isotope variations in the during the formation of water. And there you can see light water, which is H2O. That's what we commonly call water. There's semi-heavy water, which has one hydrogen and one deuterium with a molecular weight of 19 grams per mole. And there's heavy water, or D2O, which has one oxygen and two deuteriums, replacing hydrogen in water. And we probably learned about heavy water for atomic reactions, to control atomic reactions. In fact, the weight difference is so large between hydrogen and deuterium that actually deuterium in heavy water, they can slow down neutrons during nuclear reactions. So looking at the biology of a hydrogen and a deuterium bond with oxygen in this case, we can see very significant changes in physical properties of the bond itself. Hydrogen has a certain resonance per second, which is different from a deuterium bond. And the distance between oxygen and hydrogen is also different from oxygen and deuterium. Deuterium, because of its heavier at the atomic scale, it likes to get closer to oxygen, and it's also harder to cleave or remove from a chemical bond. And this difference is somewhere between 7 to 15 times harder to remove a deuterium from a carbon, a nitrogen, or an oxygen if it replaces hydrogen in those bonds. And these are practically atomic properties of hydrogen and deuterium, and it comes from the large change in size and weight, simply because if you look at, for example, C13 or carbon that has 6 protons and 6 neutrons, C12 has 6 protons and 6 neutrons, C13 has one extra neutron. It's only around 10% change in weight, not 100% change in weight and size. So hydrogen and deuterium behave very different in biological systems. For example, if you look at all the ions in plasma, and you order these lab tests very often, calcium, magnesium, potassium, and glucose are in the range of somewhere between 0.75 millimole per liter up to 6.1 millimole per liter when we look at glucose. However, when we look at deuterium, it is actually 12 to 14 millimole per liter in our plasma, and our body contains about 1.5 gram per 75 kilograms. So a 75 kilogram adult would have about 1.5 gram deuterium in the blood. Now, this is very important because Obviously, as far as inorganic elements or ions go, don't look at glucose at this point because it's an organic molecule, but among inorganic elements, actually deuterium is the highest in our circulation. So we have a lot of deuterium in our body, never measure it yet. We do now have tests to measure deuterium in various body fluids, including saliva, urine, and breath. And those are very important markers of an individual's deuterium load. If we just so you have an idea of how much deuterium there is in a 50 kilogram human being, of containing about 32 kilograms of body water, it's about 1.1 gram of deuterium, and this makes about 5.5 grams of total heavy water in anybody's body. So it is very important. It's a very important number because we do use deuterium or heavy water, deuterated water for various clinical purposes, tracing, for example, breast milk production. And I'm going to show you data at the end how deuterium seem to affect these processes. But we already have deuterium in our body. It's about 6 grams just in a 50 kilogram adult. Obviously, we can calculate it more precisely once we know the body weight and the water content. Now, the studies with deuterium go back to the, I would say, as early as deuterium was discovered back in the 1930s, when an American scientist, Dr. Urey, received the Nobel Prize in chemistry for the discovery of deuterium. And ever since, deuterium became an element that is studied and used as a label for various biological processes. One of these studies that appeared in FEBS Letters, which is the Federation of the European Biochemical Societies, appeared in 1990. And surprisingly, what these investigators discovered is that deuterium cannot replace hydrogen or protons in active transport processes in yeast, meaning that nanomotors that transfer protons either in mitochondria or at the cell membrane to get rid of hydrogen in the cell from the cells, it's a proton efflux type of situation, deuterium cannot replace protons, or deuterium ions cannot replace hydrogen ions in those mini pumps. Now, this is very significant because if this is the case, which is obviously the case, then we can modify the deuterium and hydrogen ratio in within cells by selectively pumping out hydrogen and retaining deuterium. And this seems to be a very important feature of all bacterial ATPase or ATP-dependent proton pumps, which pump protons out from the cells and to retain deuterium for their growth. And this is why bacteria and yeast are able to grow continuously, simply because their biochemical proton transfer mechanisms are able to retain deuterium in and within the cells. And we're gonna look at these more carefully when it comes to cell transformation. But the continued information based on the study is that replacement of, if we replace ordinary water with heavy water in these yeast cultures, there's a sharp reduction of the rates of primary hydrogen ion transport at the plasma membrane of ATPase, meaning that deuterium cannot be pumped out from the cells whereby hydrogen is pumped out. So because of its size, because of its weight, it does not fit with these nanomotors. And it's not only the hydrogen pumps or proton pumps, but also the symports or the secondary symports where protons are associated with the transport of, for example, sugars and amino acids, they are also affected, meaning that deuterium also interferes with sugar and amino acid transport. So it seems that when it comes to nanomotor function or proton pumping, deuterium has a very large effect on these biochemical reactions and enzyme activities. And there was even more surprised, actually this was previous to the papers that I presented, but in Nature in 1988, two Italian investigators published a paper, and they showed that actually if we infect a human cell or a fibroblast with a yeast proton pump, which cannot pump deuterium out from the cell, these cells become cancerous. And this is very significant finding because this was the first time that they showed that as simple as modifying deuterium and hydrogen ratio in cells, we can actually transform cells into a malignant phenotype. And the increased pH was because of the increased activity or increased content of deuterated water in cells. And I'm not going to go into the inorganic chemistry of this, but obviously what these investigators observed is that SAD transformation in the presence of deuterium. And this started Dr. Gábor Somjai, who is a good colleague and friend of mine. He works in Hungary, and he in 1993 published a paper again in the Federation of the European Biochemical Societies, describing that the role of natural deuterium content of water and naturally occurring deuterium, how important it is to regulate normal growth rate of cells, meaning that natural variations of deuterium in water, at that time food was not yet studied, but natural variations in deuterium in water regulates cell divisions and the growth rate of cells. And this was also a very significant finding because at that time, Dr. Somjai was working at the Hungarian National Cancer Institute, and he used, bless you, and he used deuterium depleted water to limit or control cellular tumor cell proliferation. And this is what this study describes in details. Ever since this discovery, there are many other papers addressing chronic inflammation, cell transformation, cell proliferation that actually address the cell tumor cell proliferation and cell control scenarios. And I'm going to show you data and papers that how we actually introduce these and discuss these in the medical literature with colleagues. So this is a summary slide of what to expect from mammalian cells. For example, if they are transfected with the hydrogen ATPase proton pump, the ATP dependent proton pump in fibroblasts, they start dividing and transforming, and deuterium can be introduced into cells which have the same effect through heavy water or D2O, as you can see on the upper left side, or actually through nutrients like sugars with high deuterium or glucogenic amino acids with high deuterium, and not only proton pumps but also the sodium pumps are affected, which depend on proton transport. The symports and antiports are all affected by deuterium content in cells. Now, I don't want to talk about how deuterium interferes with DNA stability. We do have papers on this topic, but actually retaining deuterium in cells metabolically are very critical and very important scenarios to determine a cell's ability and rate of divisions. Now, I'm going to show you a video here with these mitochondrial nanomotors and complex fibers, what we know as energy producing or ATP synthase. And you can see here how ATP synthase is powered by protons that are harvested by the TC cycle. There's a twofold, two magnitude difference in proton concentration outside of the matrix, mitochondrial matrix, and inside the mitochondrial matrix. There are about 300, 250. Now you can see a proton of the 250 protons versus one in the matrix that actually comes through a very small tunnel that helps protons to reach the nanomotor. And as the protons turn around the nanomotor on a different tunnel, they actually slip into the matrix. And based on this mechanic movement of ATP synthase, ATP is produced by forcing atoms in diphosphate to accept a inorganic phosphate. And as you can see, this nanomotor rotates at very significant rotation. It's an average of 3,000 to 12,000 rotations per minute. But if there is a deuterium in the proton cloud that surrounds these ATP synthase nanomotors, you can see here this red dot coming in as deuterium, twice as heavy, twice as large, and it actually breaks these nanomotors. Meaning that really, truly, and this is just one of the problems with deuterium. This is just to give you a visual aid of imagining how deuterium can dismantle protein structures, which is very common in biology. We actually use deuterium for conformational changes in mass spectrometry. And so here you can see the devastating effect of deuterium, which has been described by Dr. Ogun regarding the biological effects of deuterium being present where ATP synthase is rotating or ATP synthase enzymatic activity is high, for example, in mitochondria. Yeah, this paper was published in 2007 in theoretical biological medical modeling. And we use this model these days to assess the deuterium content of mitochondria, which should be very low for obvious reasons. And I'm gonna give you some data along the talk of how low can be the deuterium metabolic water production or metabolic water deuterium content in the matrix based on the food that we eat. Because the proton that was falling into the matrix is participating in water production with the presence of oxygen. So the reason why we breathe air and oxygen is to make water in our mitochondria using those protons that are harvested from food, provided that those are not deuterium. So practically this metabolic water production is very critical, and the low deuterium content of it to maintain mitochondrial health. And this is where the work we performed at Harvard UCLA Pediatrics, Ali Biomed Lundquist, the UCLA Translational Science Institute, and with the behalf of Dr. Paul Lee and his GCMS laboratory, and also with the National Cancer Institute. This is Ms. Pat here. I will correct this, but with the National Cancer Institute. And this work goes back to Dr. Albert Sandiardi's work, who in 1937 received a Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine by simply discovering vitamin C, which is not a simple discovery, but a biological oxidation. And among the reasons why he also one of the reasons why he received the Nobel Prize in medicine is also the catalysis of fumaric acid. People usually know about vitamin C, certainly the biological oxidation process or biological combustion processes. Those are more commonly known about his Nobel Prize, but actually in my view, the most significant part of his Nobel Prize was the catalysis of fumaric acid or the metabolism of fumaric acid. And the significance of it goes to the National Cancer Institute and Dr. Marston Linehan, who's the head of the urology oncology program there. And it goes back to his call in July of 2010, when he was calling me to find out why one of their clinical cases of kidney cancer was so rapidly progressing, and it took the life of this young lady who they reported in the medical literature. And the National Cancer Institute's report was about a clear cell renal cell carcinoma. And this patient had a single point mutation in the mitochondrial fumarate hydratase, or FH, gene, which is one of the enzymes that recycle matrix water, metabolic water in mitochondria in the TCA cycle. I'm going to show you exactly where it is, where this enzyme is, without details. But Dr. Linehan called me just to find out if we can explain from the biochemistry point of view why this cancer was so aggressive. And so here's the xenograft they used from the patient's tumor cells. And I was, as I was telling you, at the red big cross, you can see the enzymatic reaction of the TCA cycle, which recycles metabolic matrix water. These reactions take place in mitochondria. And you can see that this mutation rendered this enzyme non-functional, and the patient developed very aggressive cancers. And these cancers were so aggressive that they killed the mice in about 30 some days, meaning that this mutation, which recycles metabolic water in mitochondria, was critical in determining this tumor phenotype. Now, what was also interesting and what was also very revealing to this team is that once they restored fumarate hydratase activity by inserting the VAT fumarate hydratase gene into kidney tumor cells, it reversed the tumorigenicity, meaning that the wild type inserted tumor cells did not produce tumors anymore in nude mice. And this was almost like an unheard scenario, where you have a point mutation in a metabolic enzyme in the TCA cycle, and you can actually reverse completely transform phenotype, and these cells regained normal kidney morphology, kidney cell morphology, including mitochondrial morphology. So once you restore, this is the water recycling fumarate hydratase enzymatic step in the citric acid cycle. You don't have to look at details, but the mice were happy once they were receiving tumor xenografts that had a normal fumarate hydratase gene. And this is actually an enzyme that recycles metabolic water in mitochondria, provided that that metabolic water is produced with low deuterium in the mitochondrial matrix. And we published this paper in the Public Library of Science, or PLOS1, with the Linehan team, and our paper revealed compromised energy production because of limited matrix water recycling in fumarate hydratase deficient tumor cells. So this was the first clinical study and the biochemical reasoning behind it, showing that actually the water exchange reactions of the TCA cycle are critical in determining cellular phenotype. And this study took us to the point that we actually reviewed thoroughly the submolecular regulation of SAT transformation and how deuterium would interfere with the process simply in the TCA cycle, how the submolecular regulation occurs by recycling deuterium depleted water through these water exchange reactions in the TCA cycle. And there are three of these reactions in the cycle, which can be used for recycling deuterium depleted water into metabolism in mitochondria. And we published this paper in 2016. Ever since, many investigators and colleagues have been exploring for their fields, for their own fields. Some of them are very intriguing studies from the MIT, Dr. Senef and Dr. Carlin from San Diego, and other colleagues who actually used these scientifically. And we also did studies with Dr. Rayham, which we could not continue, but hopefully we will be able to continue shortly. So and this is how Deutenomics work started at UCLA with this Dr. Linehan collaboration, and deuterium depletion in mitochondrial NADPH production, as suggested as the epigenetic control of oncogenesis, was my first talk at LA Biomed. It was a Science Fridays talk on December 13, 2013, and there's a link for it where actually we presented this type of work to the UCLA faculty and to the Lundquist LA Biomed investigators, and we summarized our findings, and we also published papers in Cell, Molecular Cell, which is a comment based on a paper that was published there, and also we published various other papers on the topic, simply because we wanted to determine and establish the medical literature and citations that can use this type of data. But this is how deuterium depletion and mitochondrial health became very prominent in my scientific pursuit of learning about the kinetic isotope effects in cells, and especially during cell transformation. Now, deuterium content of water and food is where it all comes down to. And we measured these values as parts per million. So we calculate how much deuterium there is among a million hydrogen atoms. And if you look out the window and look towards the ocean, the Pacific Ocean average has a 155 parts per million deuterium, meaning that 1 million hydrogens in water would contain about 155 parts per million. And so is, or very similar, if we eat flour or carbohydrates with 150 parts per million, the water, after oxidizing carbohydrates from flour, we're gonna produce a water that is very close to oceanic water with relatively high deuterium content, about 150 parts per million. Now, if we eat table sugar, if we put table sugar in our coffee or in our tea, we still consume relatively high, about 146 parts per million deuterium once we oxidize that sugar into metabolic water, because everything turns into water in our body. And then how carbon dioxide, or how carbon is salvaged, and how other organic atoms are attached to hydrogen. That's another part of biochemistry. I'm not going to talk about those in details, but as far as deuterium content of the water that is produced in mitochondria, it really depends on what we eat. If we eat cottage cheese, for example, the dry part of cottage cheese, we still consume about 136 parts per million deuterium. Now, once we start eating more like ketogenic or oil or fatty food, that's when deuterium starts dropping. If we eat, for example, olive oil, the deuterium content is going to be only 130 ppm or parts per million. It's close to a 20% change or drop, or getting close to a 20% change in deuterium or drop in deuterium. And if we eat actually butter, which is from grass-fed animals, we're gonna see about 124 ppm deuterium in the metabolic water we produce from it. And if you eat fatty acids from animal fat, it's 118 ppm. Ghee, which is an Indian butter, as I understand, only has about 112 ppm deuterium. And interestingly, unsaturated natural fat at certain carbon positions and bonds may contain even less deuterium, only 102 or 110 ppm. And this is where cell organelles that use fatty acids for oxidation and hydrogen peroxide production, and also water production, come handy simply. And this is what we've been discussing with our colleagues at MIT, in Amsterdam, at the Y University, and also with colleagues from various institutions, and also presenters at the deuterium depletion conferences in Budapest, that how this different deuterium content is taken into account when we look at various organelles, cell organelles, oxidizing substrates and producing water. Because after all, biological oxidation is practically water production with heat and carbon dioxide. And if protons are used to power nanomotors, then ATP is the form of biological energy, or the biological energy that we use for biosynthesis. Now, there are significant clinical applications of deuteronomics, which I would like to cover a little bit with more details. And simply, those are very relevant to the publications that we have been and we've been in correspondence with the Yale University. The one paper we published was what to eat or what not to eat, and that is still the question. And we actually spelled out in this paper how important ketogenic dieting experiments are, and these protocols, and the fat source. And only when natural deuterium depleting potential of fatty acids upon oxidation is established should the study be introduced into literature as a ketogenic study. The deuterium depleted water yield of ketogenic substrate is strictly dependent on mitochondrial function and oxygen delivery. If there's mitochondrial defects in these patients, then deuterium depleted water may be necessary to provide low deuterium hydrogen exchange reactions for cytoplasmic, for example, for glycolysis. And to achieve a more favorable clinical outcome, these scenarios are spelled out in this neuro-oncology paper. Now, surely enough, when these Yale radiologist colleagues were trying to label glucose with deuterium, and this is a glucose tracer they used in their MRI study, what they observed is about 15.7 and about 40% loss of the deuterium from glucose when it comes to glutamine and glutamate synthesis, and acetate behaved the same. There was a significant loss in the TC cycle through water exchange in their tracer study. And there are therapeutic applications also, which I would like to cover a little bit. The Guardian just recently, I think it was a few days ago, just published a paper about the case for keto review, why a full fat diet should be on the menu. And this is a very important kind of review Guardian paper, simply because it actually cites the literature. Some of the literature is cited from Palo Medicina, which is a Hungarian clinical entity where they treat these patients. And I'm going to show one of the patients who they treated and published in the medical literature. But actually, this Guardian article cites the work of the Hungarian investigators. And this would be case number one reported in 2019 in one of the Hungarian naturopathic medicine journals or magazines. We are talking about a 6 years old Hungarian boy with abdominal pain and vomiting. And for, in the first round, they were treating this kid with steroids in 2016 because of his abdominal pain and chronic inflammation that was suspected behind it, chronic appendicitis, biliary disease, and food allergy. This is the legs with redness and inflammation of this kid. He had puffy arms and fingers, and he was obese at that time. You can see his appearance. He was showing his hands on these photographs, and his belly was exploded or bloated. They cut off, the parents cut off gluten, dairy products, and other allergens. On April 2017, he could not get out of bed. He had swollen arms and fingers, could not take care of daily activities, and that's when he was diagnosed with juvenile idiopathic arthritis. He was offered immunosuppressive drugs, and that's when the parents contacted paralytic, a potential treatment based on dietary intervention. Natural ketogenic or paleolithic ketogenic diet was introduced through paleo medicine, which I mentioned a minute ago. This is a typical diet. It has sausages and eggs with natural grass-fed animal sources, bone marrow soup. You can see a broth here, and a T-bone steak with grass-fed butter. And here is he now. On December 2018, they could leave all medications out of from his treatments. He's grown and playing soccer, and his legs are not swollen anymore, and his hands are normal, appearing normal. And he has restored energy, and he has no more pain and cysts. And this is because of the low deuterium ketogenic diet that he's consuming. The last study I'd like to show you is the human breast milk, assessed by the deuterium dose model technique with less than 30 gram deuterium in this particular scenario. This study comes from the University of Bukavu from the Republic of Congo, and the University of Brussels from Belgium, and the International Atomic Energy Agency. This paper is currently in review, so it's not published yet. I'm just trying to show you some data regarding the milk production in mothers who get deuterium label water for measuring based on dilution methods for measuring milk output. And about 75 lactating mothers were assessed in this study. 19 of them received 6 grams. It's important that 6 grams of heavy water was introduced, because that's how much. That's in the previous slides I showed you, we have about 5.5 to 7 grams of heavy water in our body. 19 mothers received 6 grams, twice as, then they had twice as much deuterium heavy water, deuterium labeled water in their system. 20 mothers receive 10 grams, 18 mother receives 50 grams, and 18 mother receives 20 grams of deuterium. And this is their milk production. The data shows that of the breast milk output is table 2 in this paper, which you can find based on the link, but they produced on a gram per day basis about 800, 739, 749, 7.732 grams of milk. And if we plot this, you can see that higher the deuterium load there is, it seems that less the milk production is. They don't, using analysis of variance, they don't find significant differences, but the trend unfortunately is there. And I'm planning to discuss this further with our investigators at Lundquist and also write a comment regarding this paper and clarify some aspects of this data. So I'd like to conclude with a few notes. Deuterium is a critical non-radiating stable isotope with significant regulatory properties in cell proliferation and transformation. Biochemical enzymatic mechanisms are responsible for its removal in healthy cells. So healthy cells, as long as their deuterium depleting potential or enzymatic reactions are not overwhelmed, are able to deplete deuterium. This is what the Yale radiologists find. Deuterium content of nutrients, including solids and liquids, so what we eat and drink, are very important, and deuterium content is a critical information to assess food safety with therapeutic implications and diagnostic implications. And we may have to reconsider deuterium as either a harmful or harmless. It does not seem that deuterium is a harmless isotope, and its use should be, in my opinion, evaluated in diagnostics and medicine. And as a conclusion, final conclusion, I'd like to point your attention to one of our science advances papers or comments in response to the Yale study, deuterium and metabolic water matter, what this means chemically, biochemically, and clinically. The link is here. It's a very good reading because we emphasize and we spell out all these important scenarios that I have been discussing in my talk. So I'd like to thank Epigenics Foundation to support some of the work back in the 2013-2015 years. I'd like to thank Dr. Gabor Shomier, who is a colleague of mine, and he also makes deuterium depleted water with some other companies. We have friends who actually now produce this in industrial scales. I'd like to thank Agi and Dr. Parli for their long time support. Dr. Lee unfortunately died, yet he's a very close collaborator and my master and my mentor in the field. I'd like to thank Esther for all the visual arts, literature, and writing. And Dr. Smith, who's the chair of pediatrics, for her support, and also at the Lundquist, Dr. Mayer and all other colleagues who we work with. And I'd like to thank Dr. Desai, Rehan Ross, and Dr. Yi for their continued collaborations, and hopefully our studies will bring some positive and meaningful results to address deuterium or deuteronomics in medicine. And I'd like to thank Dr. Osman for her many, many clinical feedbacks in the field. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention. And if you have questions, I'm happy to answer them if I can. Thank you so much.